start tonight, I want to explain something. This image you see here is not a shrine god. People are asking, is this not an occultic thing? That is part of the untold truth. It's in the Bible. It's the book of Daniel chapter 2. That image is in the Bible. So every fear that what image is that is not it's not a mystical stuff. It is in the Bible. Will you say an amen to that one? Maybe tomorrow I should spend some time to explain it for 5 minutes. Tonight is a good and a special night. Whenever good things want to happen, bad things want to precede them. We thank God so much. Today we had a very blessed morning presentation about Lodibar to the king's palace. And people have started making decisions. Some were baptized today. Tomorrow, we will baptize. Monday, we'll baptize. Tuesday, we'll baptize. Wednesday, we'll baptize. Thursday, we'll baptize. Friday, we'll baptize. Saturday, we'll baptize. Will you not see an amen there? Sunday morning, you'll do the last baptism before I go back to Ghana. Say amen there. Amen. For tonight, our theme is unveiling the Siamese twins in the Bible. Unveiling the Siamese twins in the Bible. But as I always do, it was Jesus himself who said, if you continue in my words, then you are my disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. If the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed. Will you say an amen out there? That was a weak one. Will you say an amen there? Amen. All our friends who were baptized today, when we close, I have a special gift for you. Very special. And all our guests, I want to meet you tonight. Not just that. All those who took the prayer card home, write your 7 prayer requests for the rest 7 days of the week. When we close, I want to meet you as well. If today is your first time of coming, can you wave at me? Today is your first time. You've never been here before. God bless you. When we close, I want to see you. I have a special gift for all of you for making it today. I want to make 5 promises. Promise number 1 is, the Bible is going to be the bedrock of our study. The reason is, the Bible means what it says, and says what it means. Promise number 2, you shall be enlightened, irrespective of who you are. Promise number 3, you shall be challenged to make the most important decision of your life. Promise number 4, those who love the Lord, they'll be baptized. And promise number 5, your life will never be the same. May the Lord bless the person who brought this fund here. God bless you 10 times. Yesterday night, we dealt with the untold truth about his adoption. And we spoke about baptism as a way of adoption. So those who were baptized today, they received the adoption of God. They are ready to walk. It was a decision they made. Intelligent decision. In Isaiah 1:18, the Bible says, come, let us reason together. God is a reasoning God. So when we want to make decisions, they must also be intelligent decision. Unveiling the Siamese twins in the Bible. I want to make a disclaimer. Tonight, you will make a major decision. I want to plead with you. Don't let anything distract you. And I pray and keep praying for yourself and keep praying for me that God will give me his word and he will also give you an understanding. Ladies and gentlemen, Siamese twins are birth whose skins or babies whose skins are in an internal organ are fused together. Siamese twins. They are conjoined twins. And they occur once after every 200,000 births. And their survival is not so much assured. The survival rate of Siamese twins are between 5 to 25%. Some are joined on their heads. Others are joined on their tummies. Some on their necks. Others on their navel. Some on their chests. Some others on the roof of their head. Siamese twins. But the question I want to ask tonight is this. What is law and grace? That's the question I will answer with this presentation. Law and grace. Why so much lawlessness in Nigeria? You drive along the street. People just don't like law in this land. So much lawlessness. So much recklessness. But it's not about Nigeria. It's a human tendency. It's a human attitude. Fathers cheat at work on taxes. Mothers seek abortion. Both parents cheat on each other. They give birth to new senses. Broken homes, leaving ugly scars. Who is to instill the sense of right or wrong if parents are lawless? If politicians are lawless? If pastors, we are lawless. Today, in many churches, God's law no longer applies. Today, in many churches, his commandments have been abolished. Today, in many churches, God's commandments are irrelevant and they are not needed. Today, in many churches, God's commandments are impossible to keep. Why so much lawlessness? What is the biblical understanding of law and grace in the Bible? God exhibits four laws. The civil law in the days of Israel, the health law, the moral law, and the ceremonial law. Take note of these. Four laws. The first one is called what? I didn't hear that. The first one is what? The second one is what? The third one is what? Moral law. The fourth one is what? The ceremonial law. In the civil law, it was extensively discussed in the book of Exodus, in the book of Numbers, and in the book of Deuteronomy. You will find the civil law. At that time, God was the king over Israel. It was the time this law was applicable when God was the king. We call that theocracy. Theocracy is when God is a ruler of the people. The law says, when you steal,
they should jail you.
But when God is no more the leader of the nations, our national laws, the civil laws, not all of them are in accordance with the Bible. So we can say today, these civil laws of our countries, they exist, but God is not the ruler over them. We have the health law. It's emphasized in the Levitical law. Example, Leviticus chapter 11. The law clearly promotes the principles of good health. Logically speaking, it is still in existence since human beings are still having the need for good living. Health laws. Then we have the moral law, which is in the 20th chapter of the book of Exodus. It is repeated either fully or partially in subsequent books, like the book of Deuteronomy. Could this one be irrelevant today? We will soon find out. Then we have the ceremonial law. It mostly discussed in the first 9 chapters of the book of Leviticus. It elaborates on the sacrificial system. It is called ceremonial law because it involves ceremonies and rituals. Could this be the one that was nailed on the cross? There is a huge debate. The untold truth in many churches today, people are confused. What God says, you are privileged to be here tonight for this discussion. Say an amen out there. I'm going to give a biblical evidence. You can see the secretariat if need be, if you can't copy all. I'm making a comparison between the moral law and the ceremonial law. When I say the moral law is the 10 commandments, the ceremonial law is the ritual commandment. Number one, the moral law was spoken to Israel by who? I didn't hear that. By who? God. The ceremonial law was spoken to Israel by who? In the moral law, it was written on stones by who? The ceremonial law was written in books by who? In the ceremonial law, in the moral law, in Exodus 40 verse 20, it was placed in the ark of God. And in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 25, verse 26, it was put on the side of the ark by God. The moral law, the Bible says it will stand forever. Psalm 1:1, verse 7, 8 and 9, Matthew 5, verse 38. And in the ceremonial law, it ends with the death of Christ. The question must be asked, why is there moral disillusionment in our societies today? The Bible says in the book of Proverbs, chapter 28, verse 26, it says, he who trusts in his own heart is wise, true or false? What did he say? Can you read after me? It says what? Let's read it together. Proverbs 28, verse 26, it says what? He who trusts in his own heart. He said what? You are a fool when it comes to issues of spirituality. And you are saying, I think you are a fool. Capital F, capital O, capital O L. I'm not saying it, it's the Bible. You are not wise. Don't trust your understanding. Don't trust my understanding. Don't trust any pastor's understanding. Don't trust any bishop's understanding. Don't trust any father's understanding. Don't trust the Pope's understanding. He who trusts in his own heart is a fool. The Bible put it differently in Proverbs 14, verse 12. Can we read it together? It says what? There is a way which seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death.
Could it be what you believe all these years is false? Could it be how you worship all these years is false? Could it be how you are honest with your Christianity or your Islam or your Buddhism is false? There is a way. Why would a way not be false? Because Jesus says, I am the way. It is prefixed with a definite article. This is an indefinite article. Jesus says, he is the way, not a way. We have only one truth. That is why we say the untold truth, not an untold truth. Truth is only one. Truth is never two. Truth is single. Truth is definite. Truth is absolute. False or falsehood is relative. Falsehood is an isness. Truth is an oddsness. If that is clear, say a resounding amen there.
Amen.
The Bible says, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3 to 4, it says, for the time will come when Nigerians, when Ghanaians, when the world will not endure sound doctrine. What does it mean? But according to their own desires, people go to church today to hear what will make them feel good. They go to church today to hear what will make them happy. They go to church today to follow falsehood. The Bible prophesied in 2 Timothy chapter 3, chapter 4, verse 3 and 4. It says, a time is coming when they will not endure sound doctrine. It means good Bible teachings. If the world will not endure sound doctrine, good Bible teaching, it means they will endure what? False doctrine. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible says, because they have itching ears. And I was listening to your radios and I was watching the TVs in Nigeria. I'm hearing almost every pastor. They are saying, it shall be well with you. It shall be well with you. You will go to America. Kilode, you will go to London. Mbelola, you will go to Japan. They have itching ears. Will you not say an amen there? So, people are looking for pastors who will tell them what they want to hear. The Bible says they will heap up for themselves teachers. They are looking for pastors themselves. And they will turn their ears away from what? I didn't hear that. From the what? I didn't hear that. From the what? The untold truth. They will turn immediately. You follow error. Immediately. You are following false teaching. Immediately. The Bible is not being taught. You will follow error. And if you follow error, you will turn your back against truth. Today, the law of God is walked upon. Today, the Bible is now subjected to our revelations. Let me explain. When the Bible says, thou shalt not, somebody says, I want God to reveal to me, who are you? What level of arrogance is this? God says, do this. And you say, I am special. I must be given a revelation. You will die with your revelation. The best revelation is this.
days, God has revealed himself through his son, Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, Jesus is the truth. And the Bible says, sanctify them through your word, for your word is truth. If you are looking for truth, it's not through a dream. If you are looking for truth, it's not through a vision. If you are looking for truth, it's not through any trance. The B, I, B, L, E. Will you not say an amen there? So the question must be asked, what are the rules? I'm talking about the Siamese twins. The two things in the Bible you cannot separate. God gave this formula for a crimeless Nigeria long ago. Nigeria is the superpower of our continent. Anyone who means well for Africa must mean well for Nigeria. If Nigeria gets it right, the whole Africa, they will get it right. Because 180 million people and over come from here. Lagos alone is almost like the whole Ghana. Because Ghana, we are 27 million. Lagos alone is almost more than 21 million. Lagos is just like the entire country called Ghana. Liberia is less than 5 million. Just imagine. If Nigeria become a crimeless country, they will teach. If the churches in Nigeria understand the Bible, because the whole world, the 10 richest pastors, the first three, they are from Nigeria. Nigeria is the religious hub of our continent. Arguably, the world. So listen to what God says. Exodus 20, verse 1. I'm focusing on verse 2. The Bible says, I am the Lord. Take care. Your God. Take care. Those are not children's comments. I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Let me explain. God says, I am your creator and I am your redeemer. That is the meaning. Is that how you can say amen?
Amen.
He says, I am your God. I am your Lord. I am your creator. In other words, this was the preamble to the 10 commandments. If God is your Lord, you will keep it. If God is your God, you will keep it. If God is your Redeemer, you will keep it. Do we give him a round of applause right now? He was reminding Israel the way he took them out of the land of Egypt. Then God gave the 10 commandments. Commandment number one, I am quoting from Exodus chapter 20, from verse 3 to verse 17. He says, law one. Let's read it together. He says, what? Oh, that is a weak one. Say it again. Is it a command or is it a suggestion? Oh, answer me. Is it a command or is it a suggestion? You shall not have no other gods before me. It is a command. Some of you have made your wives your God. Some of you have made your bosses your God. Some of you have made your boyfriends your God. Some of you have made your girlfriends your God. You shall not have no other gods before me. Money must not come before God. Your job must not come before God. Listen, when you are to choose between your job and God, you choose God. Anything that you love more than God is your God. Commandment number two. You shall not make for yourself a carved image. You shall not bow down to them. Not anybody's sticker.
Today I walk through Nigeria and I see some prophets who are there for profits. They are stickers. I saw in one man shop. And I said, "Sister, why now?" He said, "Na so."